Okay, we have now 9 spectators, and so we can start with the introduction. So welcome everyone to Web3D 2021. We are happy to start this adventure. This is the first session of the first day. It's where most of the problem happens, but apparently we are able to start at least this some webinar. We are live on YouTube. And we will go on as planned. We will start in a couple of minutes when we reach the 5 minutes step to allow everyone to join. I'm not receiving any message from Vuva or other channels, so apparently people were able to join as planned. And this first session is a tutorial and the title Modeling Example Extending X3D Realism with Audiograph and 3D Spatial Sound. And the authors are Eftychia, Lakka, Athanasios, Malamos, Papadaki, and Don Brutzman. They are already sharing their screen, so you should be able to see. If you be for the spectator, if you have any problem, try to contact us here in Zoom through the chat or in the Vuva app with a message or with whatever mean you may find. So mail, whatever. Let's try to get creative there. And you already see some enthusiasm from the spectators. And as I said, we are really happy to start this adventure. And it was a tough decision to go virtual, but here we are. And let's try to make the best out of it. So all the spectators can hear and see the presentation. So, cannot respond beside we're using the chat. Perfect. So it's up to you, authors. You want to start?
Yeah, maybe we can start, yeah.
Okay, so we will deactivate our video and let's maybe just the person who speaks keep the video on and the rest will follow through to the share screen. Mm-hmm. So thank you again for being here. Have a nice conference and I leave the words to the author of this tutorial. See you later.
Okay, let me introduce myself first of all. I'm Eftychia Lakka. I'm a PhD candidate. My background is computer science. And we start this session with a tutorial modeling examples extending X3D realism with audiographs and 3D spatial sound. The first presentation is about introduction and overview. I have already shared my screen, the video, because we have the presentation as pre-recorded video. I hope I can take Zoom. Okay, I share the audio and I start the video. So let me know if you can see and hear, of course, the video. I will start it and everything that will happen, we can tell me, please. So, hello everyone. Let me first to introduce myself. I am Eftychia Lakka. I am a PhD candidate and this is a short presentation of the introduction and the overview for the tutorial Modeling Examples Extending X3D Realism with Audiographs and 3D Spatial Sound. The presentations that are following after this introduction, Fundamentals of Sound, Acoustics and Sound Effects will be presented by Professor Athanasios Malamos. I will continue with W3C Web Audio API and X3D4 Sound Model Overview and some examples. After me, my colleague Maria Papadaki will analyze during her presentation joining X3D4 Sound Components and WebRTC
to create novel real-time streaming audio applications. I will end with some information about X3D4 sound component and tool support, and of course, we can close with any question, clarification, and discussion. The purpose of this tutorial is to present the introduction of new nodes in X3D graphics specification in order to be extended both with special sound attributes and with physical effects. The proposed structure is harmonized for use with the Web Audio API and HTML5. The tutorial provides an overview of fundamentals of sound and acoustics, the improved X3D4 sound component, and an overview of W3C Web Audio API. Multiple example scenarios are shared for evaluation of the proposed approach using the new X3D nodes in an interactive Web3D scene, taking the advantage of the concept of audiograph. So during this tutorial, we can discuss about sound propagation and acoustics, X3D sound modeling, Web Audio API, and spatial sound. And the objective is to have a discussion for clarification and possible improvements for modeling and modifying high fidelity advanced audio using web standards, particularly X3D4, HTML5, and JavaScript. Here is the overview of the tutorial. Indeed, X3D4 Graphics offers new extensions for the high fidelity capabilities of W3C Web Audio API, providing advanced 3D spatial sound propagation. This tutorial explores multiple examples in X3D and JavaScript for implementing the 20, if I remember well, new nodes in X3D4. The concept of audiograph is central to the composition of X3D and the W3C Web Audio API recommendation too. Tool support includes strong validation of audiograph relationships and structure. X3D edit additions provide further support for testing models. X3DOM additions for the X3D4 sound component are evaluated in detail, providing recommendations for other player implementations. Future work includes implementing acoustic properties for realistic high fidelity aural rendering. So we can start, and I will give the floor to Professor Malamos for his presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Effie. Thank you very much.
Okay, would you like to share again the video, or you can? I can do it for you if you like.
I will do it myself.
Okay.
I will share my own video.
So I stop my camera and I will do it.
Okay. I hope that you see the screen. There's no sound.
I'm not sure we hear the audio though. You have to, when you share the screen, you have to also say share okay. Audio.
Okay, I understand. Share audio. More. Share sound, yes. Okay, I start from the beginning again.
Sound is a wave. As a wave, it travels inside the means, like air or water. Traveling of a wave inside the material, inside the mean, is created, is done by variations of the density of the material. So the material is vibrating and the density of the material is varying through from one side to the other through all the mean. And so the sound is propagating from one side to the other. In the first page of the presentation, you can see an image which is a simulation of the variation of the density of the mean and the corresponding pressure variations, which are like sine wave. Since sound is a wave, it has the typical wave parameters like frequency, speed, and wavelength. If, for example, we assume that speed of sound in the air in typical conditions is almost 340 meters per second, so for the acoustical band of frequencies from 20 hertz to 20 kilohertz, the wavelength of the sound waves is varying from 70 meters up to 70 millimeters. Sound level and sound intensity in general is measured in watt per square meter. Sound power is measured in watts. And sound pressure is measured in micropascals. However, when we want to express the sound level in order to use it, to compare it, we don't really use the units and the measured value, but instead we use the rate of the measured value over a reference value. And this rate is expressed in decibels because we don't just get the rate, but instead we are getting the logarithm of the rate multiplied by 10 in the case of intensity and power, and multiplied by 20 in the case of pressure for calculations, let's say, reasons. Indeed, pressure is the parameter which is easier to measure because we have instruments to measure pressure. For example, a microphone. A typical microphone is a pressure measurement instrument indeed. For simplification, we consider source of sounds to be point sources. Point source means that we don't consider geometry or dimensions for the sound source itself. And this could be true if we consider that we are measuring physical parameters of sound in a distance from the source, which is sometimes the wavelength of the sound source, of the sound. In this case, we may consider and simplify the reaction of the sound as it is a point source of a sound. In general, since we consider sound as a wave, it should react like a wave whenever it hits a surface. And indeed, we consider that sound follows the wave physics rules and laws. Reflection. when sound hits a surface, it is reflected. The way that this reflection appears, if it is going to be specular or diffusion, it has to do with the surface and the sound wave. If the surface is smooth, then in this case it is specular reflected. The sound is specular reflected. Specular reflection means that the sound changes direction, but as a whole, the whole amount of sound is changing direction and goes to an angle which is equal to the incident wave angle in respect of the, of course, surface normal. If, on the other hand, surface is rough, has anomalies which are deep, deeper than the sound wavelength, then the sound will reflect to many directions and not just to one direction. In this case, we said we have a diffusion. This is the case we are trying to do in audio studios, for example, or in auditorium, where we would like to hear the physical sound comes out of the singer, for example, or from an instrument, but not to allow the sound to reflect and create second and third and fourth reflection sounds. Okay? So we try to put materials in the walls of the room that diffuse sound or even absorbs sound, but not specular reflect sound. Diffraction. Diffraction is a phenomenon that appears when an incident wave hits in a surface which is very narrow, as much as the wavelength of the sound, or it has a hole which is as wide as the wavelength of the sound, or the wave hits, strikes in an edge of a surface. In this case, we have a regeneration of the sound. It is like we are inserting new sources of sound exactly at the point that diffraction takes place. Refraction. Refraction is the phenomenon that appears when sound is passing from the border of two different materials, of two different means. Refraction means that the sound will change the direction and also the speed while it is propagating inside the second material. In the generic sound strike into a surface, we may expect that all the sound physical phenomena will appear at the same time. For example, while the sound strikes, and depending on the specular reflection coefficient of the surface material, we may have specular reflection. Perhaps some of the sound will be diffused as well because of some anomalies in the surface, and some other will be refracted. So, whenever we are studying the interference of sound with surfaces, we have to consider that according to the material, the geometry of the surface, and the wavelength of the sound, we may have more than one physical phenomena appearing. One interesting thing, and especially very interesting thing in the case of virtual reality we are dealing with in this tutorial, is how the ear localizes the sound. When the sound is very close to our ear, then the localization is taking place by calculating the brain, of course, by calculating the sound that comes directly to the inner ear area and the sound that is coming after reflection of in the outer ear area. So these micro differences in the sound that is coming through reflection or directly in the inner ear area makes our brain capable to specify where exactly the sound is coming. We may say here that, and we may look in the left image, that our ear doesn't hear all the frequencies in the same way. So our ear doesn't really have a flat reaction to the sound. And this is a matter of anatomy of each one of us and of our, let's say, tympanic membrane flexibility that changes, we may say, during the years. So if we change the azimuth of the sound, we'll see other transfer function to appear for our ears. And also, we may notice that we have different transfer function, not only depending on the azimuth or elevation of the sound, but also depending on the ear, right or left. So our ears are very sensitive to small variations of direction and small variations of intensity of sound. Thus, when we try to localize a sound which is far away from us, we use this sensitivity, ear sensitivity, to point to the sound. The ear that is closer to the sound hears the sound in different phase than the ear, the other ear. And also, the ear which is closer to the sound hears the sound in different intensity, higher intensity, because we know that sound is decreasing as the distance is increasing. Thus, our brain estimates the azimuth and the elevation of the sound and the distance, I may say, according to the phase, the different phase or phases between two ears and the different of the intensity. It depends on the frequency of the sound, whether it will use mainly the phase difference or the intensity difference, as we see in the presentation. We are simulating the way that human ears hear and the brain calculates and estimates the sound position to create 3D audio effects. The effect that we are dealing with mostly here is spatialization. And this is because we aim to use this specialization, virtual specialization of the sound into virtual reality spaces in order to create better immersion of the user into the sound environment. This is done by using the head-related transfer function, and indeed by using a database of several different measurements of head-related transfer functions into several azimuths and several elevations. So in this case, we may simulate the specialization of the sound and make the user hearing from the headphones or from the speakers, as we may see, hearing sound coming from different directions as a simulation result of head-related transfer function and real sounds. There are 3D sound commercial systems presented in the market, like Aural 3D, for example, or Dolby Atmos, which are trying to create a sound dome around the user. They are putting speakers around the room, not only in the elevation of the sound of the user ears, but also all around the room as a dome. And by using virtual techniques, they are creating the immersion that is required for the case of theaters or auditoriums or games and etc. Thank you very much. In case of questions and discussion, you may visit us in our tutorial, or you may send an email to us and we will reply to you as soon as possible.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so thank you for your presentation. I will follow with another one. I prepared a pre-recorded video. Actually, it's 30 minutes. So before that, maybe I can explain two things in order to can be in line with the tutorial and with the presentations. As I said in the beginning of the tutorial, the idea is to present and analyze how can we how propose to extend X3D4 with audio nodes. We try to keep in mind that Web Audio API is one of the most famous API that using to processing and put a video in web applications. So we already harmonized this structure and nodes in X3D4. For that reason, I prepare a video presentation that try to analyze and give some high level information from Web Audio API. But in the end of this presentation, we can find an explanation from the examples that we have already developed based on X3D4 audio nodes and give some explanation. Of course, after that we can discuss it and live, and maybe we can see some code, etc. Let me share again my screen. Okay. And I hope that you can see my presentation and thus see the sound. Okay, let's start it.
Hello everyone, this is a presentation for the tutorial modeling examples extending X3D realism with audiographs and 3D spatial sound. And especially I will try to analyze W3C Web Audio API and X3D4 sound model, giving an overview and explain some examples. In this presentation, first I'm going to provide the basic concept of Web Audio API, an introduction, the concepts, the workflow of the interfaces, and I will give a simple example for better understanding and analyze the audio routing graph that is used by Web Audio API. Then I will share with you the corresponding X3D audio graph, and I will try to compare and highlight the same aspect, both of them. and I will end with some code to explain our developed examples in spatial sound using X3D sound nodes and the WebAudio API. So let's start with a first glance of WebAudio API and some high-level definitions that can help you to be in line with the following presentation. The specification is the collective work of the W3C Audio Working Group. It is an active working group with a lot of work and continuously updates of the API. It is characterized as an extremely powerful tool for controlling audio in the browser and be supported most of the browsers, as you can see in the figures. Generally, it is a high-level JavaScript API which can be used to synthesize audio in web applications. It supports modular routing that allows, let's say, arbitrary connections between different objects. To clarify that in web audio, objects are the nodes. Each node can have inputs and or outputs. A source node has no inputs and a single output. A destination node. Other nodes such as filters can be placed between the source and destination, and there is a connection, let's say, between the objects. I will follow in the next slides with the concepts of web audio. The web audio app is built around the concept of an audio context. Audio nodes are basic elements of audio. The idea of modular routing is to connect the nodes with each other, and finally WebAudio API characterized by the audio routing graph actually is the network of audio nodes that created by this flow. If we want to explain the workflow, we can say that the audio context is a directed graph of audio nodes that defines how the audio stream flows from each input of an audio file to its destination like speakers. The simplest audio context is a connection between input and a destination with some environment-specific sound effects being mediated, such as specialized sound, filters, audio processing effects, analyzer, etc., as you can see the figure in the slide. In the next slides, I provide the interfaces of WebAudio API, the nodes of API. Starting with abstract nodes, audio context and audio node, with the latter being the parent of most interfaces that are included in WebAudio API. The audio context represents an audio processing graph built from audio modules linked together. It's represented by an audio node. An audio context controls both the creation of the nodes that it contains and the execution of the audio processing or decoding. You need to create an audio context before you do anything else, as everything happens inside the context. The audio node is a generic interface for representing an audio processing module. Each audio node has inputs and outputs, and multiple audio nodes are connected to build a processing graph. This graph is contained in an audio context, and each audio node can only belong to one audio context at any time. And finally, the audio param represents an audio-related parameter, usually a parameter of an audio node, such as, let's say, the gain value of the gain node that we will explain in the next slides. Continue with the WebAudio app interface's input, actually the sources of the sound. In fact, WebAudio app makes a clear distinction between buffers and sources nodes. Taking a record player analogy, buffers are like records and sources are like playheads. So the audio buffer interface represents a short audio asset residing in memory created from an audio file. On the other hand, audio buffer source node represents an audio source consisting of in-memory audio data stored in an audio buffer. An audio buffer source node has no inputs and exactly one output, which has the same number of channels as the audio buffer. An audio buffer source node can only be played once. after each call to start function, you can create a new node if you want to play the same sound again. Audio schedule source node represents the common features of source node, such as audio buffer source node, constant source node, and oscillator node. Another one, constant source node, represents a constant audio audio source whose output is nominally a constant value. To be honest, the two last nodes until now I have not tested them, but okay, they are available in the API and I'll try to describe it. We continue with the next one, the oscillator node. This interface represents a periodic waveform, such as a sine wave, can easily be used in audiographs in place of audio buffer source nodes, and is used to synthesize our own sounds, let's say. The MIDI element audio source node, the interface represents an audio source consisting of an HTML audio or video element. The media stream audio source node operates as an audio source whose media is received from a media stream obtained using the WebRTC or Media Capture and Streams APIs. This media could be from a microphone or from a remote peer on a WebRTC call. There is another representation of this tutorial that explains example using WebRTC and these nodes, and you will see in practice how can we use it. Finally, a media stream track audio source node represents an audio source from a media stream track, which is media of a single type that originates from one media source in the user agent, e.g., for example, video produced by a web camera. Continuing in the other category of nodes, we finished with inputs and now effects are followed. The first one, the analyzer, is used for the visualization part of web audio API. It is a node able to provide real-time frequency and time domain analysis information, passes the audio stream unchanged from the input to the output, but allows you to take the generated data, process it, and create audio visualizations. The next one, BigWet filter node, is a simple low-order filter and can represent different kinds of filters, tone control devices, and graphic equalizers. Another one, IRIF filter node, implements a general infinite impulse response filter. In general, it is the best to use BigWet filters, the preview ones, to implement higher-order filters. So again, until now I have not checked, but okay, it's available in the web audio API. The next convoler node performs linear convolution on a given audio buffer, often used to achieve a reverberation effect. The delay node represents a delay line. It is an audio processing module that causes a delay between the arrival of any input data and its propagation to the output. The dynamic compressor node provides a compression effect which lowers the volume of the loudest parts of the signal in order to help prevent clipping and distortion that can occur when multiple sounds are played and multiplexed together at once. Examples that this is often used are in musical production or game audio. Another one, gain node, represents a change in volume, is maybe the most usable node in practice to change the volume at the scene. We continue with stereo panner node, a simple stereo panner node that can be used to pan an audio stream left or right. The pan property takes a unitless value between minus one full left pan and one full right pan. This interface was introduced as a much simpler way to apply a simple panning effect that after that having to use a full panner node. We will explain in the next slide. The wave shaper node is a non-linear distorter for warmer sound, let's say. And periodic wave defines a periodic waveform, and it can shape the output of an oscillator node. Periodic wave represents an arbitrary periodic waveform to be used with oscillator, if we can see it. In this slide, split and merge, two nodes, the channel splitter node and the channel merger node, often they are used in conjunction, based, as you can understand on their name, the first one separates the different channels of an audio source into a set of mono outputs, and the second one reunites different mono inputs into a single output. You can see the corresponding figures in the slide. For the specialization of the Kobodi API, which is the most important part of this API, two main nodes are included, the audio listener and panner node. Actually, there is a single listener, the audio listener, attached to the WebAudio API context that can be configured in space through position and orientation. Each source can be passed through a panner node, which specializes the input audio. During rendering, the panner node calculates an azimuth and elevation. These values are used internally by the implementation in order to render the specialization effect, like a panning algorithm from the panner node. So the WebAudio API, taking into account relative positions and orientations, each source has a configurable audio cone, a model that describes the loudness of oriented sound. As you can see the figure, sound cones are made up of the inner, the outer, and the neither cone. Each of these subspaces are used to express that an oriented sound is loudest in the direction of orientation. Both panners and listeners have a position in 3D space using a right-handed Cartesian coordinate system. The units used in the coordinate system are not defined and don't need to be, because the effects calculated with these coordinates are independent of any particular unit, such as meters or feet. Panner node objects have an orientation vector representing in which direction the sound is projecting. On the other hand, audio listener object represents a person's ears, have forward and up vectors representing in which direction the person is facing. You can see in the figure, the coordinate system for specialization. The attribute panning model of panner node is one of the most usable and important, because determines which specialization algorithm will be used to position the audio in 3D space. The default value is equal power, but there is another option, HRTF. The first one, equal power, is a simple and relatively inexpensive algorithm which provides basic but reasonable results in which the elevation value is ignored. And the second, HRTF, which means head-related transfer function, is a response that characterizes how an ear receives a sound from a point in space. So this is where the effects nodes, and I finalize with a category of destination, the out of the final sound. There is the audio destination node, represents the end destination of an audio graph in a given context, usually the speakers of your device. It has no output and one input. And media stream audio destination node is an audio destination consisting of WebRTC. After the analysis of the nodes that WebAudio API includes and their role in very high level, we can analyze a simple example of the WebAudio API. Any audio nodes output can be connected to any other audio nodes input by using the connect, here it is, the connect function. In the example of this slide, we should create the context, the source, and the gain with a corresponding function, as you can see in the piece of code. Create audio context, create buffer source, create gain. We connect the source node's output into the gain node and connect the gain's node output into the context destination. This is the idea, to create all the nodes that you need. Of course, source, destination, and only gain in this example. And the last row of the code, you can see that you connect the source with gain, the gain with a destination. It's worthwhile to notice that the context destination is a special node that is associated with the default audio output of your system. The resulting audio graph of this code looks like this figure. In short, the idea of audio routing graph in web audio app is to get an audio stream, the input from a certain place, and send it to a destination after real-time calculation and processing, which is also called effects for us. After a complex input or destination choreography, you can get a routing graph like this in slide. I will continue to explain a little bit the concept of X3D audio graph as we try to give you the overview of the corresponding graph of web audio API. I'll try to give an explanation of X3D audio graph and highlight that we try to take the advantage of the routing graph of web audio API and harmonize both the audio graph and nodes that are registered in X3D4. So the main purpose of our proposal is to link X3D language that is used to represent 3D content in existing adaptive high-level API for processing and synthesizing audio in web applications, of course. As I have already mentioned before, web audio API is essentially a graph of nodes that process the signal. Thus, if we could turn this graph into a visual XML-like tree, it would be easier to understand, manipulate, and reuse it through an X3D scene. How this has been achieved? By the introduction of native X3D components with a few lines of code that are explored. This is the idea, this is the advantage. So from X3D perspective, X3D uses a scene graph to assemble all the nodes that make up the virtual environment being modeled. The scene graph is a tree structure that collects all aspects of a 3D scene in a hierarchical structure. In the same way, the proposed X3D audio graph consists of the corresponding syntax that offers features for configuring a hierarchical structure audio graph with any number of connected audio nodes. Let's explain a little bit more in order to verify the validity of our design. The new registered nodes in X3D4 and the proposed structure were applied to several exams that have already implemented, and one of them is depicted in this slide. We use X3DOM to create 3D scenes and animations through HTML. In the following example, there are two sound sources in different positions. The idea is through the immersion in the X3D scene, the user could attend a rational navigation. Whenever the camera moves in the direction of an existing sound source, the strength of this source increases, while the sound strength of the other, the second one, decreases, and vice versa. So this example can be represented in X3D like this code. And in the right side of the slide, you can see the corresponding hierarchical connectivity of nodes and the resulting audio graph in X3D. This means that the audio nodes in X3D model can be declared using XML nested elements, where the parent-child relationships represent the connection between nodes in the audio graph. The structure starts with a topmost audio element for each independent audio graph. The inputs to each node are provided by its children, and similarly, the outputs of each node are provided to its parent. Let's see exactly the comparison. So we have the audio destination node is used as parent of any other audio node. This is the last node of the graph. We started in the opposite flow. It represents the final destination of the audio signal and is what the user can hear in the corresponding element graph. Accordingly, there are two sources that are passed through separate spatial sounds. Here it is. This is used for the spatialization of the input audio. For each source, a gain node is used to amplify or deamplify the input signal, and of course, each audio clip for emitting audio data. And if you can see, this technique is structurally consistent with a corresponding web audio API, and you can understand from these two graphs that if you compare two separate graphs, that the first is nodes from XML node that we proposed and registered in X3D, and this graph represents the flow of nodes in web audio API. So based on this comparison, you can understand that try to harmonize the names of nodes, the role of nodes that have in web audio API, but of course, and the flow, the graph. The result, the advantage of this to understanding the tree from X3D models is sufficient to utilize the translated audio components, and no further knowledge is needed regarding JavaScript programming of the web audio API framework. Consequently, users with X3D modeling background can use the proposed audio framework to develop and, of course, integrate interactive Web3D scenes, including immersive spatial sound. After these slides, I prefer to show you some code and explain the examples that we have already implemented. Let's continue with the code. Before that, I should remember that for these examples, use X3D4 audio nodes, X3DOM, and the web audio API. All these nodes that we proposed in X3D, there are registered in X3DOM. So let's start in opposite flow. What I mean, the first example is the split channel. A sound source is included and can be moved right and left depending on the position of the sound source. The user can hear the produced sound from the corresponding output speaker. In the right side, here it is, you can see a live diagram. Let's see, that is a die, is a live, is a live diagram of web audio API that describe which nodes is needed to implement this this specific example. We have an audio buffer source, a channel splitter, two gain, one for either a channel merger, a gain, and the final audio destination. If you see, this diagram is a live diagram from X3D nodes, sound nodes that we use for this specific example. Let's see. We have audio buffer source, audio clip in X3D, channel splitter in X3D, two gains node for any channel. Channel selector is the one that we don't have in web audio API, but we use to define which channel we use at any time. Channel merger, gain, and audio destination. This is the corresponding nodes from web audio API to X3D version 4. So this example that we have presented right now in X3D, actually this is the tree that we have in X3D in order to do developing. Let's see that in X3D XML tree we have the opposite directions from the graph. We start with audio destination. We use a new node that there is not in a web audio app listener point source. Actually, from this node represents the position and orientation of a person listening to virtual sound in the audio scene, and provides single or multiple sound channels as input. It has an attribute, the track current view. So if the track current view, as you can see here, is true for us, means that then position and orientation matches the user's current view. This means that the listener is our camera in the 3D scene. So we continue with the gain 3 here. Gain has one, actually in the graph has one children, one parent channel merger, but before the channel merger should be define the channel splitter that will be used as parent both of two channel different merger, the gain, and the channel splitter who has the sound audio clip as parent. This is the idea. For this example, we have the corresponding JavaScript that we run all the scene in order to find, to define and find which type of X3D, which types is transform, let's say, find audio destination, listener point source, the gain node, channel splitter, and after that we saved as a list in order to use it for the part of web audio app. This means that we should create the corresponding gain nodes, the corresponding audio buffer source, the corresponding channel splitter, but from the side of web audio app. And if you see, we have the connection between them in order to create this graph. So the next example is this one that I have already described in the presentation. Again, in this side, we can see live the nodes and the graph and the flow, let's say, from web audio app that we'll use in order to have the sound in web. Here it is the corresponding graph from X3D nodes. Again, audio buffer source in web audio app, audio clip in X3D, a gain node, a spatial sound, this is the panner node from web audio app, and after that, audio destination. And of course, two sources, one saxophone, one violin, and try to give you the X3D code about this. If, as I have already mentioned, start the XML tree in the opposite right of the graph, start with the audio destination, two spatial sounds, any spatial sound has a gain, this one, and an audio clip. For that example, the corresponding JavaScript code again, try to have all the nodes from the scene saved in a list, and after that try to use it in order to create the corresponding code of web audio app to have the sound. Create gain, as we explain in presentation about the example in the web audio app, create buffer source, connect a source with the gain, connect gain with a panner, etc. And the last one is filters. We have three sounds, three sound sources, and we use it at any source some filters, a low pass, high pass, etc. We change some attributes of this only to test that working okay. See again the graph from web audio app. We have three sources, so three audio buffer source. Any source have bequet filter, analyzer, gain, and panner, and all panners connected to again the main volume, let's say, in order to be in a dynamic compressor. This is used only to have a smooth sound result, and the audio destination. We'll try to have the same the harmonization with the nodes of X3D, audio clip as audio buffer source, bequet filter, analyzer, gain, spatial sound like panner, and of course gain, dynamic compressor, and audio destination. Again, the code of X3D started in the opposite, started with audio destination, listener point sources to, as I said, to give you that the camera is the listener, dynamic compressor who has one children gain, but the gain has three children, three spatial sound children, and then a spatial sound high gain, analyzer, big wet filter, audio clip. This is the idea. So this is the presentation for the tutorial. Try to give some examples in WebAudio API to explain what exactly WebAudio API do and how, which is the proposal, which is the proposal in X3D4. Thank you very much. We can continue with any questions or some explanation in the code. Thank you again.
So this is the end of the third presentation. As I said before the video, I try to give a high level of WebAudio API nodes because we use it in X3D to and have the harmonized with the graph and the nodes. And as you can see, I try to explain how we developed some examples in order to justify that all this structure and the idea is working in web browser. We can continue with Maria's presentation. Is another example, Maria?
Yes, give me a second. I moved rooms. Hopefully that will help with the tutorial later.
So I will close my camera and my phone, my microphone and...
So I do not have a pre-recorded presentation. I'll talk live to know if that's good or bad, we'll see. So to prove the concept of what Effie just described, we developed another application, a tutorial to see how we could use X3D for sound components with real-time communication. Basically, our application is the result of combining different state-of-the-art tools, and we developed the application with the potential to involve and become an authoring tool for theater directors to use and orchestrate their own online performance. We aim for real-time communication, sound specialization, and a good control over the amount of clients. The technologies that we used is HTML5, JavaScript, X3D and the X3D4 library, WebAudio API, WebRTC, Node.js for our server, Socket.io and Axios library. Effie already described what X3D is. The X3D4 library is a major upgrade so that we could provide support for HTML5 and WebAudio API. WebAudio API is a high-level JavaScript API used for audio processing and synthesizing. The X3D4 library combines auditory and visual information under the XML declarative language. And our nodes are used to store information for both the visual aspects of our scene and the audio. WebRTC is an open source project that provides real-time communication for browsers. It allows peer-to-peer connections and the exchange of media and binary data. Our clients will connect to a Node.js server and exchange notifications through WebSockets. Stan and Turn servers. A Stan server stands for Session Traversal Utilities for NAT, and we need it in order to be able to retrieve the IP from our peer. In case Stan fails to retrieve it, we turn to Turn, which is traversal using relays. It's a relay server. It usually has latencies, and our traffic is relayed through that server instead of real peer-to-peer connection. We have set up our own Stan and Turn servers for the purpose of the application, just to make sure we have a safe connection. The architecture of the WebRTC application is ASFU. It stands for Selective Forward Unit. In the image, you can see what it's like. the performer and the client and the spectator will connect to the Node.js server separately, and the each client will create a unique peer-to-peer connection. They will not create a peer connection with each other. The server is as a mediator. Now, when you're logging in as a client, you have to connect either as a spectator or as a performer. In either case, you have to use a username that exists in the list that we have provided in the homepage. The username is not just to identify you, it represents a specific avatar inside the scene, and your camera and audio will adjust to your position. As soon as you have requested the HTML page, you'll be prompted to give a username. We have provided the list, it's on your right right now. And if all the requirements are met, you will receive a message of success. Otherwise, you'll have an error. This bidirectional communication is based on Socket.io, and it enables event-based real-time communication between the browser and the central server. Any notifications coming from the server will appear on the announcements board. For every client, there is a new incoming message. Every time there is a change, a client logs in, someone leaves, or a stream starts and ends. Spectators are informed to click the stop stream button after all three performers have started streaming. Spectators are also notified when all performers have logged off. Providing that the server has accepted performer, they can begin streaming by pressing the start stream button. It will signal the central server and will create a peer connection between the two. The client sends the offer and the server replies with an answer. After the connection has been established, the performer can add their audio stream on top of the peer connection. On the other hand, if you have logged on as a spectator, the process is the same. You will send us an offer to the server and they will reply with the answer. And the server will add the stream it has received from the performers to your connection. The audio will pass through sound specializations filters after it has arrived. Now, both clients can leave the performance anytime they wish just by pressing the leave stream. The rest of the participants will be informed by a socket message, and the connection with the server is terminated. In case you do not stop the stream before closing the tab, the server will detect that you left through the socket and proceed to remove you from the list. This is an example of how the scene displays the information. There are many types of nodes. Most of them we have already seen through Effie's presentation. In the image, you'll see audio destination, spatial sound, gain, and microphone. Microphone source exists in the X3D4 library, and it basically says that the audio source is a microphone device. In the audio destination, there is a parameter called def, which we use right here. It is paired with the use parameter in the transform node. Now, it connects basically the location of the audio destination. It tells you where the sound is emitting from. That's how we combine them. The transform node stores information that the panner will later need. And the panner, as we already said, represents the position and behavior of an audio source. And that's it about the presentation.
Thank you, Maria. Could we have a demo or something? I mean, could you give the chat box the URL?
So I will provide you with a URL in the chat. We have included three spectators. So three of you can log in and choose basically one of the names that we have mentioned. One of you will be spectator one, another will be spectator 2 and another one will be spectator 3. We will be logging in as the performers. In fact, we might start off by logging in first and then I'll send the link so that we are ready. Effie, do you have the link?
Yes, I have it. I have already joined as a performer 3.
All right, I'm joining as performer 1. Mr. Malamos, you're going to log in as performer number 2.
I have done.
All right. So you see on my screen, it accepted me, found that there is nobody else using this name already. I'm pressing OK. And I am going to start the stream and accept it. Now, I'll send you the link. You can write in the chat who wishes to join in, so you don't try at the same time. Oh, sorry.
Oh, I believe you you share the address only with the organizer, so you have to send to everyone. I can. Now we should be.
Let me
visible
try.
Visible
yeah.
To all the spectators too. Okay, perfect. You did the same.
Thank you.
Nadio. Hello. Is it working?
Did anyone log in as a spectator? I'm providing the names here so you can use it when you're prompted to. If you get an error message, it's possible that somebody else tried to connect with the same name. I see a spectator 3. Since I'm staring at my screen, you probably see the announcement board. If the person that is logged in as spectator 3 is online, they can say who they are. So we know that they can hear us through the application too. All right, I'm going to log in as spectator one. Just give me a second. I can hear you. I don't know if you can hear the audio from my computer. I'm gonna.
No, I cannot.
You have to share first. You have to share something in order to hear. Share the application, the browser or something. Ah, you have already shared, yes. Okay. So open the sound as well. Can we hear? I don't know. We can right now. We don't hear the sound from your computer. Okay. Anyway.
Does anybody know how to do that? Because
you go. Let me.
When you start sharing the screen, there should have been a checkbox saying "Share also sound," and now you should change it from one menu, but I cannot.
Effie, are you still logged in as a performer?
Yes. Yes, I am.
Okay, so if you can hear Effie, it's because you can hear her through the application.
Can you hear me? Actually, Maria, the others can't hear me because I listen to myself and I don't know.
I can hear as well.
Yeah, and Zoom is unmuted, so you can hear me from the platform.
Yes, I do, but I don't know if anyone else is inside. But anyway, we will leave it in this URL. One thing is that if you have problem to reach this URL, this is because we're using an academic HTTPS license, and sometimes some browsers does not support this license, okay? So perhaps you have to bypass this HTTPS question about the legality or whatever the browser asks, and go on with the URL and the website. Okay, so if you have problem, so you can test it. We have some notes on the HTML on how you can link to the site. I mean, how you can become a performer or a spectator, and in this case, you can check. One thing which is it could be very interesting, and we will appreciate very much if we could have your help, is to measure delays and how these delays are affecting the quality of the final performance. So it could be a good idea if some of you could voluntarily cooperate with us and make some experiments with this platform. I may say here that something that Maria I don't remember if she mentions that, is that we are using our own servers, I mean, Stan and whatever it is necessary to do so. We are using our own servers, dedicated servers for this case. So we can test, let's say, without traffic, at least in servers, without traffic, we can make our tests without having external traffic. Okay, so we don't share a public or open servers. We are using our own dedicated servers. So it could be a good idea if we could join us and make some tests, especially concerning not only the X3D part, which is something we would like to evaluate anyway, because of the effort we have done in order to make all this specialized sound, but also the communication part. We are interested to test the communication part concerning the WebRTC delays and how we can work with these delays and if they really affect the performance. So, Effie, what is next?
Okay, thank you, Maria. Let me open my camera. The last presentation, as I already described the nodes and the interface from WebAudio API, I will try to describe and to give the definitions of the audio nodes from X3D4. Let me share my screen again. Okay. That's right.
Hello everyone. This is a presentation for the tutorial modeling examples extending X3D realism with audio graphs and 3D spatial sound. And I will focus on analysis of X3D4 sound component and the tool support. So in this presentation, after a short introduction, I'm going to provide the basic concept of X3D4 sound component. I will continue with the abstract audio nodes and the high level of explanation. After that, the same for the rest of the audio nodes, and I will end with some information about the audiograph nodes evaluation using tools. X3D4 Graphics offers new extensions for the high-fidelity capabilities of WebAudio API, providing advanced 3D spatial sound propagation. As has already mentioned and from the other presentations of the tutorial, the concept of audiograph is central to the composition of X3D and the W3C WebAudio API recommendation. In X3D, we use a children field in the most of audio nodes that represent a set of input nodes with the current node continuing creation of the audiograph. Additionally, tool support includes strong validation of audiograph relationships, and the structure and the X3D edit additions provide further support for testing models. I will be more detailed for the interface of X3D4 sound component. Generally, sound component of X3D4 includes how sound is delivered to an X3D world as well as how sounds are accessed. It provides a rich set of specialized audio capabilities in a comprehensive architecture suitable for 3D models and virtual environments such as signal sources for sound, virtual locations for sound generation, propagation and reception points. Also, it considers physical models of sound propagation. So I will start with the abstract audio nodes that have been registered in X3D4. First is X3D sound channel node. This is the base node type for nodes that handle of channels in an audio stream, allowing them to be split or merged. X3D sound destination node. This is the base node type for all sound destination nodes, which represent the final destination of an audio signal and are what the user can hear. Some nodes are often considered as audio output devices which are connected to speakers, and all rendered audio that is intended to be heard gets routed to this terminal nodes. The next is X3D sound node. This abstract node type is the base type for all sound nodes. The next one, X3D sound processing node. This is the base node type for all sound processing nodes, which are used to enhance audio with filtering, delaying, changing gain, etc. And the last, X3D sound source node, the abstract node is used to derive node types that can emit audio data. In this hierarchical diagram, you can understand better the structure of audio nodes. As I said, we have the X3D sound node with the child nodes, periodic wave, sound, and spatial sound. And the other, X3D sound channel, X3D sound destination node, X3D sound processing node, and the final X3D sound source node, in order to classify the all other audio components. To mention here that X3D nodes are defined in an object-oriented fashion, and X3D naming conventions follow a specific design pattern. Names for concrete instantiable nodes are kept simple and functional. Abstract nodes types begin with X3D and the end with node. Since many W3C audio API classes end with node as well, and we want to be harmonized with the API, distinct names are needed for clarity even when semantics are identical. So based on the diagram, let's start with X3D sound node group and proceed after with the others. In the group of X3D sound node, we have the periodic wave that defines a periodic waveform that can be used to shape the output of an oscillator. The sound specifies the spatial presentation of a sound in X3D scene. The sound is located at a point in the local coordinate system and emits sound in an elliptical pattern. And the spatial sound that represents a processing node which positions, emits and specializes an audio stream in 3D space. This node provides full specialization of panner capabilities defined by W3C Web Audio API within an X3D scene. And here you can see special sound panning gain relationship for listener in the figure. So the cone inner angle is centered along direction and defines the inner conical volume inside of which no source gain reduction occurs. And the cone outer angle is centered along direction and defines an outer conical volume. The next group is X3D sound channel node that includes the channel merger, units different input channels into a single output channel. The channel selector selects a single channel output from all input channels. If the selected channel is not monophonic, further splitting remains feasible. One of the usable fields of this node is the channel selection field. which indicates which channel to select with index values beginning at zero. And the last, the channel splitter, the opposite of channel merger, separates the different channels of a single audio source into a set of monophonic output channels. Let's continue with a group of X3D sound destination node. The first node that belongs under this is the audio destination, represents the final audio destination and is what user hears, typically from the speakers of a user device. Only to notice that an audio destination node represents the audio hardware endpoint, can potentially output more than two channels of audio if the audio hardware is multi-channel. The other is stream audio destination, is an audio destination representing a media stream with a single media stream track whose kind is audio. Actually represent an audio destination consisting of a WebRTC media stream. These slides contain the group of X3D sound processing nodes. The first node of this is analyzer, provides real-time frequency and time domain analysis information without any change to the input other than gain amplification. The next one, Bequet filter, represents different kinds of filters, tone control devices and graphic equalizers. Low order filters are the building blocks of basic tone controls, bass, mid, treble, etc. Graphic equalizers and more advanced filters. Multiple Bequet filter node filters can be combined to form more complex filters. The filter parameters such as frequency can be changed over time for filter sweeps, etc. The next, the convolver, performs a linear convolution of on a given audio buffer, often used to achieve a reverberation effect. Potential modifications include chorus effects, reverberation and telephone-like speech. The idea for producing room effects is to play back a reference sound in a room, record it and then take the difference between the original sound and the recorded one. The result of this is an impulse response that captures the effect that the room has on a sound. The next one is the delay. Causes a time delay between the arrival of input data and the subsequent propagation to the output. The dynamic compressor implements a dynamics compression effect, lowering the volume of the loudest parts of the signal and raising the volume of the softest parts for more smooth results. The gain node is the volume of the input audio. And final, the wave shaper represents a non-linear distorter that applies a wave shaping distortion curve to the signal. Non-linear wave shaping distortion is commonly used for both subtle non-linear warning or more obvious distortion effects. Arbitrary non-linear shaping curves may be specified. And the final abstract group is X3D sound source node. We have the audio clip, specifies audio data that can be referenced by sound nodes, actually is the most common node for the input. Buffer audio source represents a memory resident audio asset that can contain one or more channels. Typically, the length of the pulse code modulation data is expected to be fairly short, usually somehow less than a minute. For longer sounds, such as music soundtracks, etc., streaming, stream audio source should be used. Actually, is the last node that is presented in this slide. Another node, listener point source, represents the position and orientation of a person listening to virtual sound in the audio scene and provides single or multiple sound channels as output. Multiple listener point source nodes can be active for sound processing, and if the track current view field is true, the position and orientation matches the user's current view. Another one, the microphone source node captures input from a physical microphone in the real world. It has a field, the media device ID field, which is a unique identifier for the represented active device that is used by the scene and the development. And the last one, oscillator source, represents a virtual audio source generating a periodic waveform providing a constant tone. So these are all the registered audio nodes in X3D and their role in which way can be used. Except the above, we propose the node acoustic properties that specifies the interaction of sound waves with the characteristics of objects in the scene. Properties influencing sound propagation include surface-related physical phenomena, such as the specular reflection, diffuse reflection, absorption, and refraction coefficients of materials. We have proposed the syntax and the fields, and we are working for the functionality of these characteristics. Actually, is the current work and the next development for us. I finish with the components of audio sound, so I would like to mention that is available the tool of X3D validator which support the structure of X3D4. So all the examples that we have implemented and we share with you pass this validator, so means that it's compatible with the philosophy that just present. In this figure you can see that all audiograph nodes from X3D was tested and passed. Also in X3D XML schema there is a strongly typed validation and represents all the information of any node and which nodes can be used as children, a fact that is very helpful for the XML tree design of the audiograph in X3D code. And that's it. This is the end of my presentation again. I'm Eftychia Lakka and my email is available. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
So this is the end of all presentation. Actually, we have 20 minutes, so we can start with a discussion, questions, any suggestion, any feedback, please free.
Can the administrator allow us to open our camera? Is it possible? Thank you very much.
Yeah, Effie, Thanos, Maria, totally awesome. Looks great out here in California. Bravo.
Thank you. Thank you. Effie,
we do hope to encourage many people to implement this API to duplicate and extend your work. And I know you've been focused very hard on the JavaScript and X3 DOM. Do you think that is repeatable by other implementers? Will they be able to add these good notes by using the W3C audio API, where most of the audio work is done, and you've merged them with the 3D world? What do you think? Is that possible?
Yeah, actually, this is the aim, to have all this JavaScript behind the X3D, and all the users that know X3D can, with XML3, have the audiograph and implement any example that would like to have a 3D spatial sound. This is the idea, to have all the JavaScript behind the X3D and use it from XML3.
Thank you.
So are there questions from the audience? Spectator, you just can raise hand or write in the chat or just or write in the Google channel.
I could offer another point, and that is there were some questions in the chat about, well, where are the routes? Why didn't you have to connect everything? And I think your examples are really clear. When we use this kind of parent-child relationship, it makes it so much terser. If you turn your head sideways, then the XML almost looks like your audio graph. So just as a promise to everybody, we expect to, in the coming months, we will try to convert the X3D sound notes into audio graphs directly, perhaps JavaScript, perhaps a diagram, but just playing back what was in the chat, this notion of scene graph and audio graph interspersed seems very powerful, very powerful. Did I just have too much coffee this morning, or do you guys think this is powerful too?
You see, I think that this, let's say, combination of X3D, which is a cross-platform, anyway, framework with many different implementations with Java, with JavaScript, and etc. So if you combine this 3D tool framework with technologies like the for example audio technology, or also moreover the demo that Maria presented, and she has used also a communication platform, so a communication technology. So all these things are creating, let's say, the appropriate framework to create novel applications. I see a question in the chat that is asking how we can benefit in the medical sector, how they can benefit from what we have done. I don't know. Only the people that are working in the medical sector, they know the way they can use what we offer. But what we offer is this cross combination of several frameworks, of several technologies, communications, 3D and sound, or in general physics, let's say simulation. So each one of us, they can, depending on what they are working on, we can benefit from all these technologies and create novel applications. What Maria tried to do was a virtual theater, let's say, where the authors, the performers are joining from abroad, from different places, and also people, the spectators, are entering also through the web from several different places as well. So this is a new product, a new service, we may say.
Somebody asked if we could add more spectators, and the point of the application is that it's simple enough to understand how the scene is created, and add more models and spectators with a different ID. And it works the same. If somebody reads the HTML file, it's easy to understand how to add more spectators. And there is no limitation to the amount that you can add. We kept three for simplification reasons.
Only, I mean, no, sorry.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yes, Sophie.
Only to add about the medical domain, that maybe we don't know yet how can we use it, maybe for training, I don't know, but should be very careful with the security of this domain because you have sensitive data, etc. This is the first idea that I have in my mind, but of course it's a very good question that we can have in mind.
That's why I mentioned already that only the people that they are working in a certain area, they know better than us about the applications they can. What we are doing is offering opportunities of technology, and the applications are, you know, for the people that are working in specific areas. Another thing is to clarify that what Maria used and did is like a new Zoom, because she was using the Zoom framework. I mean, the WebRTC framework, which is the framework we are using right now to make all this conference, you know, happen. And so, let's say, imagine of a Zoom, for example, that gives also special capabilities, like echoing and doing things that are, of course, used mostly in art or in other applications, and less than in a typical teleconference. But anyway, this is going to be useful. I mean, the whole let's say technology is going to be, for me at least, the future. Internet, the future social media interaction, the future. This is going to happen, and I'm very anxious, and I'm very and I'm waiting, you know, to see what's the next step of Facebook, for example, with metaverse and etc. Because I cannot imagine a future to the internet and to the social medias without virtual reality, without 3D, and without all these tools that this technology give to us and we can use. So, okay, that's our main effort here, and that's what we are doing.
Thank you.
Thank you all for your presentation, and remember that the discussion may go on in the VUVA channel, and the video will be made available at the end of the day, so people also in other time zone will be able to see this presentation. If there are other question, yeah, see people just continue posting on the chat. We can go on a few more minutes and waiting for the opening, and I want to see you all at the opening.
To a question about the head related transfer function I see in the chat box, I may say that yes, there is an assumption, of course. First of all, it is let's say a statistical measurement of head-related functions, and not just from a certain person. Of course, it could be an idea on using some kind of a technology to tailor head-related functions to each one of us, and because in this way it could be better. It could be better. Also, you can check. We can play with the parameters of head-related transfer function in order to do what you, William, you suggest here of modeling non-humans, creatures, or I don't know, animals or decide and specify how they really hear. It could be a good idea. Hi, Dick. Dick is saluting us. Dick is one of the guys. We are working close the last two or three years. I don't remember exactly in this subject. Richard Pook.
And don't add another thought that I have in my mind, that the idea for me is to target people, not programmers, like performers, clinical, I don't know. So the ideally, maybe it's we finalize to have a tree with nodes and drag and drop nodes in the platform and create the 3D spatial sound in the platform. This is the ideal for me. Maybe we start with the first step and continue with the others.
Richard, what we did is a very, very small and simple version of what you described. We could easily follow the same logic and create a hole where your seed is your ID, the name that you give when you log in, and the same for presenters. Somebody also said that it's how could this be used for educational purposes? Somebody could create a virtual classroom and have the teacher walk around amongst the students and talk to them, so it's more realistic. For example, in my university, we use Big Blue Button, and it's nowhere real what a real classroom sounds like. And somebody else, I don't remember who, said something about fabrics. The fabric could be considered the audio destination and connected with a transform so that the sound emanates from that source, the material. I don't remember if I saw something else.
Okay.
Well, maybe one last reaction. Tanos, you and I have seen companies come and go. Very good companies. And they often consider their business model based on a customer base. And they often have had capabilities that are less than what you've shown today. It's interesting to think what a company might do when they consider their customer base to be everybody on the web.
I may answer to William as well. He is asking about about the head-related function. I may say that we are using a simplified version of head-related function. So it is anyway an assumption, okay, not a detail, but it is something that someone can work and make some progress if it is, in your interests, and we can support you, or we can work with you if you like in this area. Of course, it is something interesting to us. I mean, head-related functions. In any case, you can make measures and do such things by using also dedicated instruments for this case. So we can chat if you want, or you can send an email, and we can chat about this some other time later, perhaps.